a lot of master bedrooms these days are just getting unnecessarily large. Many have these awkward sitting areas, but just too much room for activities. Well, we wanted to fix that. So after much thought and deliberation about simple bookshelves, shiplap, etc., my wife came to me with the idea of a fireplace. Instead of what? Like a fireplace? Absolutely. Yes, ma'am. Absolutely. Yes, ma'am. I will get to work on that. To be honest, she wasn't wrong. Because who doesn't want a nice cozy fireplace to curl up by with a nice glass of wine or even a few fingers of whiskey? Cheers. I'm Pat. This is Nesbilt Design Co. And in this video, I'm going to show you how I frame that fireplace. So let's get to it. First up, demo day. So we start with taking out all the trim. You always got to make sure to cut out all the caulk first. And then when you're trying to pull it out, get a trim puller. It is a game changer and you won't punch any holes in your drywall. Next up, taking out the carpet. If you're doing controlled demo, a laser is a game changer for that. And the next tip with trim is always make sure to cut out all those joints first. It makes life a lot smoother. And then once you get the trim off, always make sure to scrape off all that caulk so your next round of trim will sit flush. Every project starts with proper planning and layout. Pro tip, you can use any of your tape as a marker. But from that sketch, I worked outside in to get my stud dimensions. I'll take this booty shot moment to introduce our sponsor, Carhartt. Just kidding, I'm not actually sponsored by them, but they should get a piece of this action while they can. Then to transfer my mark down to the floor where I needed to actually use the laser. Again, those guys are so handy. Then I actually squared it all up in my framing square and marked out the front face dimensions. Hammer time! Then to lay out the front face, I used my third hand, aka a nail, and my chalk line. Ooh, look at that. You gotta see that again. That's satisfying. Now with your layout, always make sure to back check your work because you want to know now before you start standing studs. Frickin' laser beams. But you gotta love them, especially plumb bob lasers, because those make jobs like this so much easier because no one uses the plumb bob anymore. But you gotta make sure you got a laser that has the plumb bob function on it. Another tip for my job site layout days: always leave your laser on when you're driving in nails for stuff like this, so that way you can back check and you know your nail's gonna be dead plumb. So after I back checked, you can see I already laid out all the rafters here, and where I want my sides to go, I don't have anything solid to attach to, so I marked out my studs here and then actually punched through so I can transfer that and find it in the attic and know where I need to put my blocking. Cut it, cut it, cut it, cut it. These boards are way too long. I had to cut them. So now we're up in the attic and you can see the holes that I punched through from down below. So it actually marks out where my blocking needs to go and makes it really nice, easy, and simple. So it's easy to knock my blocking in so I can know my top plate has something solid to attach to. Just tap it in. Because yes, I have a perfectionist problem. But it's worth it because it's gotta hold up to the weight test. Oh yeah. So for the front face, instead of actually taking the time to work out all the measurements, I just grabbed a piece of scrap and then used that to actually strike the back line for the top plate that I'm gonna put in. Now here, I cut out all the drywall, and apparently that's pretty controversial, but I wanted this to be as solid as if it was built with the house, because I've got tile, fireplace, TV, floating shelves, cats on those shelves probably, so I wanted it to be rock solid. But if you do this, just stick with the multi-tool. Now, unless you've been in the carpenter game for like 30 years, go ahead and keep your square with you to make sure that all your cuts come out nice and clean. So the next thing I did here is actually put the board in place to mark out the rafters ahead and then come back down and put the screws in while I'm not working over my head. Oh, what the hell? This is why you wear your work boots. And now you can see what I'm saying about making life a whole lot easier when you pre-drill your screws. And if you don't use your drill as a hammer, be even DIY, bro. And to quote DeResta, if it looks straight, it is straight. Now for the sides for the top plate there, I just used GRK framing screws, not the structural screws. My blocking was only so thick and I didn't want them to go too deep. But boom, there you can see some of my favorite screws out there. GRK screws, because you'll see in a minute how well they can just suck that board tight to the floor and it's gonna be rock freaking solid. Always back check your work, and this is how you know you did a bang up job. Oh, son of a, screw you, Tate. I don't even like you. Stay on the floor. All right, so as past me takes a slacker break, that's also a reminder that when you're doing big projects, you should take breaks because, you know, this is hard work. But also, if you haven't, just please take this time, this little intermission to like and subscribe. All right. All right, get back to work. Yeah, you gotta get to work, buddy. Come on. Okay, thanks. All right, back to it. Before anyone even asked, I do not know why I put the inside stud in first and not the outside. Sometimes my brain just decides other things are just the better way to go. Now the clamps may seem like a little bit of overkill, but I guarantee you that's gonna pay off in the end when you go to hang your rock. Dead plum studs. That's always gonna make life easier. So then I moved on to mounting my stud to the wall, but the next one over isn't quite centered. It actually lines up with where I wanna mount my floating shelves. Now back to layout and why it's always important. So one major thing I wanted to accomplish when putting in the cabinets and the fireplace, I wanted the top of the cabinets to line up with the top of the fireplace. So I actually marked out everything along the wall, then transfer that over to the framing, and then use that to relative measure to everything else. And another little tip here, if you're trying to make some kind of opening nice and level, always mount that bottom piece first and then come back and infill the supports later. So real quick, I'll talk about framing nailer options. So this is actually the compact framing nailer by Passload. They sent me that to test out. It is a pretty freaking sweet nailer. Super lightweight, super compact, and getting all those narrow spots like the studs down below. Now this next thing here is the side pieces for the fireplace itself. So I actually went down to the shop and planed down some pieces for that so I make sure I got the width for the opening of the fireplace just right. If you ever cut one of your studs just a hair short, here's a cool trick I learned from Instagram actually. Just pop a nail in there and it only wedges out just a hair more, and that's just what you need to get that stud to sit in there. If it's for interior stuff, it'll get the job done every time. And last up is blocking. If you ever cut any blocking short, so these are called handy shims. I use them in my shop for all kinds of things all the time. Super handy. You can find them on Amazon. So the lower blocking is actually going to be for the mantle I'll install later. And the top row of blocking is for the future TV mount. So one thing I did, you see my layout lines on the side there, actually using that top of fireplace line and my plans, I lined everything up. And that's all she wrote, folks. There's the full framing for my fireplace, blocking and all. Now it's ready to rock, literally. So stay tuned for my next video on tiling.